to the speaker, and thank you to everybody who came here this morning, and we will be back here this
evening. Is Dr. Misono, who's talking on the mechanism of bifunctional DeNOx catalyst, something that Keith had worked on, as you know, many times. And Dr. Misono worked with Keith Hall in the period of 1968 to 69. And Keith will be here momentarily, but I'm sure the introductory remarks will be appropriate anyway.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I thank Professor Gates and also Professor Keith Hall. Just for providing this opportunity. It's my great honor and pleasure to participate in this symposium honoring Professor Keith Hall. And I also thank all the people here, still here, and I thank even just you, you present, so you may feel free and sit back and relax. I don't try to wake up. my talk today is about the mechanism of DeNOx, particularly the reduction of nitrogen oxide by hydrocarbons. We are doing this to improve the catalytic performance for this reaction, or to design better catalysts for this reaction. And I'd like to describe some of our recent progress relating to the reaction mechanisms of bifunctional catalyst. I remember when I joined the Keith Hall's group 30 years ago, I studied, not like other people, studied the reduction oxidation mechanism or properties of copper ion held in solid acid matrix. After 30 years, this redox properties has something to do with the decomposition of nitrogen oxide. That will be the eternal subject for the DeNOx. I'd like to talk about three things in short time, all related to the bifunctional mechanism of DeNOx using hydrocarbon in the presence of oxygen. The first two are about the reduction of nitrogen oxide by propylene, and one is about the mechanical mixture of manganese oxide and cerium oxide for dry condition, and the combination of the same manganese oxide and the tin zeolite for wet conditions. And the last one will be the mechanism of reduction of NO by methane over palladium, hydrogen, ZSM5 in comparison with cobalt HZCM5. Let me very quickly review the evolution of hydrocarbon SCR. Following the finding of Yamatani Kawagara's group about the significant activity of copper ZSM5 in 1986, although this catalyst was not good enough in under very low concentration of NO, because the reaction order is higher than 1. So if you decrease the concentration of NO, the rate becomes very low. And also, the rate is very slow in the presence of, as all of you know, in the presence of oxygen, water, and surplus. However, if this catalyst was applied to the real Lindbergh gasoline engine, it works significantly worse to some extent. And there are several patents from those water bottling companies in late 80s. Probably Toyota was promoted promoted to try this, depending on this discovery. And Volkswagen may be quite independent. Anyhow, it was found this works to some extent. And what is interesting in the reactions, not the catalytic decomposition, but reduction of nitrogen, fairly selective reduction of nitrogen oxide by hydrocarbons contained in the exhaust gas of automobiles. After that, there are many catalysts discovered to be active for this reaction. And during the, among the activities, we found cerium during the very basic studies using cerium series of rare earths loaded catalysts to see the effect of the electron state on the catalytic reduction in all. And we eventually found cerium and praseodymium loaded zeolite was quite active for this reaction. Then we tried to improve the catalytic activity of this catalyst, and it was found this catalyst was quite active, at least for reduction using propylene. Even at space velocity of 100,000 per hour, our catalyst showed quite high activity as compared with kappa zero. So we extended our study and by using cerium zeolite. And based on the several to make long story short, we concluded the reaction proceed according to this reaction schemes. First, NO is oxidized to NO2, then quickly react with propene to form nitro or nitrite compounds, and which then decompose in the presence of nitrogen oxide or oxygen to nitrogen, sometimes nitrous oxide. And we found cerium function in the first step and also in the last step. This is very rapid. In the case of propene, we don't need to take care of this. So the idea, our idea to improve the catalytic performance of this catalyst is to use two different catalyst components, one for the first step, the other one in the second step. Because zeolite, as you well know, is not stable enough. We need to get out of zeolite property. And to do that, we need to, it seems that only one component cannot solve that difficult problem. So we try to bring two or more components and combine those components to give higher performance. This is our basic idea to improve the catalytic performance. So far, it seems very useful, but I'd like to discuss about this point after this presentation. Anyhow, first we did is keep this cerium zeolite for the second step and try other steps, other catalyst component for the first step. You know, what is important is in this reaction is selectivity or competitiveness between the reaction of NOx and oxygen. If this reaction is fast, we have high performance, and this, if this is rapid, useless oxidation of hydrocarbon takes place. We tried various metal oxide for the first step, and we mixed those metal oxide with cerium zeolite. After several attempts, we found manganese oxide and cerium oxide were quite effective to improve the catalytic performance, as we reported some time ago. We found higher performance. This is a combination of manganese oxide and cerium zeolite. This is a combination of cerium. But in those cases, we have worse, you know, negative effect of the combination. However, if you look at the oxidation of NO to NO2, the first step of our reaction scheme, chromium oxide and manganese oxide show about the same performance for the first step. But if those two are combined with cerium zeolite, manganese oxide is okay, but chromium oxide is very bad, worse than the cerium zeolite itself. So to develop the principle of the combination of two catalytic components, I thought it necessary to make clear why manganese oxide is okay, but chromium oxide is not good. At high temperature, because the conversion of olefin is higher, faster on chromium oxide, the reason may be obvious. I don't show you the result. Combustion of useless combustion of propene takes place too far. So in the case of chromium, cerium zeolite doesn't have enough propene for the reduction of NO. And at low temperature, the reason is not clear because propene still remains in a significant amount at the outlet of the catalyst. So there should be enough propene for zeolite, cerium zeolite. Finally, we concluded that there were several possibilities, but finally we concluded the mechanism at low temperature is different for the case of manganese oxide and chromium oxide. The typical results are shown on this transparency. In the case of manganese oxide and chromium oxide, in this case, oxidation of NO at the steady state is quite high, and when you introduce propane into the system, this is the reaction we studied before, the oxidation of NO decreased significantly, but we have still nitrogen dioxide in the outlet of the catalyst. So there are nitrogen dioxide, and when remove hydrocarbon from the feed, the nitrogen dioxide goes. What is very interesting is the change takes place rather rapidly. In contrast, in the case of chromium oxide, although the activity in the absence of propene for nitrogen oxidation is about the same, but when propene was introduced to the feed, the formation of nitrogen dioxide completely disappeared. And at the same time, carbon imbalance, measure the carbon material balance. The carbon material imbalance is quite significant at first and then decrease gradually. And if you remove propene from the feed, the activity of formation of nitrogen dioxide recovers, but it takes place very slowly, and also the change of the formation CO2 takes place slow. That means the surface on the surface of the catalyst, polymerization or carbon deposit of propene took place. So the change is very slow, and also the polymerized propene suppressed the oxidation of NO2. So in the case of, therefore, this is a cartoon to try to show you the mechanism. In the case of manganese oxide, it's okay. NO is oxidized quickly, and NO2 can react propene. But in the case of chromium, at high temperature, propene is uselessly oxidized to COX. So the cerium zero don't have enough hydrocarbon to reduce NO. but at low temperature, the mechanism is different. And because of the deposit coming from propene, NO cannot be oxidized to NO2. That's the reason why the combination of chromium and cerium zeolite was not good, although in this case it was good. So we need to, there are two things. At high temperature, useless combustion hydrocarbon is very important. At low temperature, polymerization of carbon deposit on the surface of the catalyst component is a very important factor to affect the catalytic activity. Then we moved on to the water resistant or water tolerant DeNOx catalyst. I'm dealing with a reversible part of the activation due to high water. What was very interesting to us, that we eventually found with manganese oxide, that manganese oxide can oxidize NO into NO2 regardless of the presence of water. As you see, the conversion of NO to NO2 showed about the same value in wet condition as well as in dry condition. So that is a good thing. A more interesting effect, this catalyst, manganese oxide, is very active for oxidation propane in dry condition, but under wet condition, the oxidation, useless oxidation of propane was much suppressed. That means this is good for bifunctional catalysts. So we can expect good result, which in the presence of water. So now we fix the first catalyst component, manganese oxide, and tried to find good partners for manganese oxide. After many screenings, we finally found the combination of manganese oxide and tin zeolite was very good. Those values is the maximum conversion of tin, and this is the temperature which gave the maximum conversion of nitrogen oxide to NO2. And what is more interesting for us is that if you compare the performance in the absence of water with the performance in the presence of water, the catalytic activity was much higher in the entire range of reaction temperature. Again, I explained this result, dividing this temperature region into two parts, higher temperature and lower temperature regions. At high temperature, as we expected, because the oxidation of NO is not suppressed by water, but oxidation of propane is suppressed. That is good. So we can expect higher catalytic activity. Actually, we found with fuel zeolite component acceleration of the NO reduction. But as for the low temperature region, tin zeolite was the only catalyst component among we study, which was able to increase, accelerate the reaction in the presence of water. And then we try to find the reason for the low temperature region. The one reason is, again, polymerization. In the dry condition, there is some carbon imbalance. But in the presence of water, the carbon balance is quite good. So this means water suppresses polymerization. And the bottom is shown the effect of the water to react with carbonaceous or polymerized product from coming from propene. At this moment, this feed was changed to NO2 and NO2 or NO O2 and water. If you look at this, if you don't have water, the nitrogen formation is very small, but if you have water, when the heat was changed from this to this, we see a sharp increase of nitrogen formation. And if you look at the carbon part, please take care about this is about 1/10 of this value. So this is almost comparable. Carbon is also reacted by the introduction of water. And when the temperature was raised, in the case of water, we see small amount of carbon deposit. And also small amount of nitrogen formation. So this means in the presence of water, low temperature, polymerization is suppressed by the presence of water, and also the surface species becomes more reactive in the presence of water. This is, we suppose, the reason why we have higher catalytic activity in the low temperature region. I think the region is not easy to explain. Then the finally, this is third and last topic. This is about the NO reduction by methane catalyzed by palladium hydrogen zeolite. As we reported previously, oxidation of methane, this is the case for methane. Oxidation of methane, which takes place during the reduction of NO, was almost the same for palladium supported on hydrogen zeolite and sodium zeolite. But if you look at the reduction of NO, only palladium hydrogen form was empty. The palladium supported on sodium is not active at all. And we already reported based on the relative rates of those reactions and by the comparison of those two catalysts for these reactions, we concluded that the reaction mechanism is most likely as shown in this scheme. Nitrogen oxide is oxidized to NO2 protonic site, and methane is activated by palladium to form methyl, probably methyl, and those reaction two species react on in the presence of proton to form nitrogen. This is a mechanism we proposed before according to those comparisons of relevant reactions. What we did recently is to see the relative importance of those three steps. As Noel already mentioned and already reported, in the case of cobalt 5, this reaction, the CH bond cleavage is rate determining, and the other steps are rapid. So we apply the same method to this system. So this is an example to measure hydrogen isotope. We used methane with light hydrogen and heavy hydrogen. For example, at this temperature, NO conversion NO2 is linearly related to contact time. From the ratio of these two slopes, we can evaluate the hydrogen isotope in this reaction. The results are summarized in this table. At the typical reaction temperature of 673 Kelvin, we observed for the hydrogen isotope 1.65. This is much smaller than a hydrogen isotope effect reported by Noel. And in his case, the CH bond scission is rate determining, and the isotope effect was about 2.6 or 7, something like that. But in our case, it is rather small. And what is surprising, at least for us, is that hydrogen isotope effect decreased when the reaction temperature was lower. If this reaction step is rate determined, it should increase when the reaction temperature is decreased. So this means the small volume and the decrease of the isotope effect with a decrease in reaction temperature indicate that the CH bond dissociation is not the sole or only rate determining step. There are other slow steps which become slower at low temperature. In accordance with that idea, if you start, this is slow, but they're not sole rate determining step. That means the other steps are comparable or slower. In accordance with that idea, I am repeating what I said before, if we start with nitrogen dioxide, we can neglect this step. So we may find higher hydrogen isotope. In accordance, as expected, we found higher activity. And also, when you use NO2 instead of NO, the reaction rate became higher. All those results are consistent with this reaction step is also slow and becomes slower at low temperature. However, there is another thing. Even for this, the isotope effect became smaller at lower temperature, which indicates that third step, this is also slow and becomes slower at low temperature. So the conclusion we draw from this result is the relative rate of these three important reaction steps in this reaction are comparable. And the relative rate of these steps change with reaction condition, reaction temperature, or from a kind of hydrocarbon, and partial pressure of oxygen, and so on and so on. And actually, we found some HD exchange during the reaction, which support that CH bond cleavage is not the only rate determining step. Then, may I speak 1 or 2 minutes more? Okay. Then we try to compare our result with the result reported by Cobalt Zeosin, which is very well known. The reaction rates are almost comparable. It changes depending on the reaction conditions or the way of preparation, but if you compare the data, they are almost comparable. However, if you compare the reaction orders, they are quite different between the two catalysts, but particularly with respect to nitrogen oxide. The reaction order in nitrogen oxide is very high in the case of palladium, but it's very low with respect to nitrogen oxide in the case of cobalt. So this is, there's very big differences. More striking difference is that the effect of nitrogen oxides on the oxidation of methane. In the case of our palladium zeolite, methane oxidation is quite fast, and the presence of nitrogen oxide suppresses the rate of oxidation of methane. But in contrast, in the case of cobalt zeolite, this reaction is very slow. By the presence of nitrogen, there are no data here, by the presence of NO, the oxidation is accelerated. So this is a kind of jump to the conclusion. In the case of methane, in the case of cobalt zeolite, nitrogen dioxide absorbing on cobalt activated methane, NO2 dissociate the CH bond, and this is slow step. But in the case of palladium zeolite, this activation is taking place on bare palladium. And the relative rates of several steps are almost comparable. Summarizing what I reported or I wish to report. The first ask for the protein reaction. Appropriate combination of two catalyzed components is very useful for animal reaction. The two component function in different steps. For example, the combination of manganese oxide and selenium is okay, but the combination of chromium is not good. In the presence of water, combination of manganese and skin zeolite is okay. And at low temperature, polymerization or formation is very important factor to control the reaction and the reaction mechanism. And number two is about methane production. For this, I can summarize our result that the co-presence of gladium and proton is very essential for this reaction, as we reported before, and slow step change with reaction condition. And in contrast to the case of cobalt zeolite, palladium zeolite activate methane directly. Thank you for your kind
attention. One or two quick questions. See if we have something
else. Master, you say one of the main reasons why water promotes the desired reaction is that it suppresses the undesired polymerization of the deposit on the surface. So, on our iron cesium-5 catalyst, we also find that water reduces the amount of deposit, but we believe it is not suppressing the polymerization, it's rather promoting the revolatilization of that deposit. And the reason why I said it is when you analyze the COX product, there is always some carbon monoxide formed, and with water, you form more carbon monoxide than without water in the iron case. And that is the opposite of what you would expect on the basis of the water gas shift reaction. So therefore, we feel the conclusion in our case is that water volatilizes the deposit in situ. How is it in your case? Does water have any effect on the CO2 ratio?
We didn't examine in detail, but I know your suggestion, and I should examine your suggestion in more detail. But I suggested two roles, as you said. One is suppression polymerization. The other is to make the surface deposit more reactive. I think the second one is what you suggested in your case.
I'll ask one question, just a generic question. In this bifunctional catalysis, you have treated these things almost as if they are operating independently. Is there any communication between those species in these particular reaction cases?
What is very sure is that there is a communication through the intermediate. You know, in order to focus on one component, you have in the second component. So in that sense, it is very certain there is communication. We do not know whether there is a direct interaction between the catalyst component in the viewpoint of materials science. We haven't examined that. We are more inclined to explain communication through the gas phase.
Okay.
At least qualitatively, we can explain the result.
Thank you, speaker.